This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book The Life Story of Insects by Geo. H. Carpenter. Chapter 1, Introduction. Among the manifold operations of living creatures, few have more strongly impressed the casual observer, or more deeply interested the thoughtful student, than the transformations of insects. The schoolboy watches the tiny green caterpillars, hatched from eggs laid on a cabbage leaf by the common white butterfly, or maybe rear successfully a batch of silkworms through the changes and chances of their lives, while the naturalist questions yet again the how and why of these common though wondrous life stories, as he seeks to trace their course more fully than his predecessors knew. Fig. 1. A. Diamondback moth, Plutella cruciferum. B. Young caterpillar, dorsal view. C. Full-grown caterpillar, dorsal view. D. Side view. E. Pupa, ventral view. Magnified 6 times. From Jorn. Department Agric. Ireland, Volume. I. Everyone is familiar with the main facts of such a life story as that of a moth or butterfly. The form of the adult insect, Fig. 1a. is dominated by the wings, two pairs of scaly wings, carried respectively on the middle and hindmost of the three segments that make up the thorax or central region of the insect's body. Each of these three segments carries a pair of legs. In front of the thorax is the head on which the pair of long jointed feelers and the pair of large subglobular compound eyes are the most prominent features. Below the head, however, may be seen, now coiled up like a watch spring, now stretched out to draw the nectar from some scented blossom, the butterfly's sucking trunk or proboscis, situated between a pair of short hairy limbs or palps, Fig. 2. These palps belong to the appendages of the hindmost segment of the head, appendages which in insects are modified to form a hind lip or labium, bounding the mouth cavity below or behind. The proboscis is made up of the pair of jaw appendages in front of the labium, the maxillae, as they are called. Behind the thorax is situated the abdomen, made up of 9 or 10 recognizable segments, none of which carry limbs comparable to the walking legs, or to the jaws, which are the modified limbs of the head segments. The whole cuticle or outer covering of the body, formed, as is usual in the group of animals to which insects belong, of a horny, chitinous secretion of the skin, is firm and hard, and densely covered with hairy or scaly outgrowths. Along the sides of the insect are a series of paired openings or spiracles, leading to a set of air tubes which ramify throughout the body and carry oxygen directly to the tissues. Fig. 2. A. Head of a typical moth, showing proboscis formed by flexible maxillae, G, between the labial palps, P, C, face, E, I, the structure M has been regarded as the vestige of a mandible. B, basal part B, of maxilla removed from head with vestigial palp, P. Magnified. Such a butterfly, as we have briefly sketched, lays an egg on the leaf of some suitable food plant, and there is hatched from it the well-known crawling larva, Fig. 1b, c, d, called a caterpillar, offering in many superficial features a marked contrast to its parent. Except on the head, whose surface is hard and firm, the caterpillar's cuticle is as a rule thin and flexible, though it may carry a protective armature of closely set hairs or strong sharp spines. The feelers, Fig. 3 it, are very short and the eyes are small and simple. In connection with the mouth, there are present in front of the maxillae a pair of mandibles, Fig. 3mn, strong jaws, adapted for biting solid food, which are absent from the adult butterfly, though well developed in cockroaches, dragonflies, beetles, and many other insects. The three pairs of legs on the segments of the thorax are relatively short, and as many as 5 segments of the abdomen may carry short cylindrical limbs or prolegs, which assist the clinging habits and worm-like locomotion of the caterpillar. No trace of wings is visible externally. The caterpillar, therefore, differs markedly from its parent in its outward structure, in its mode of progression, and in its manner of feeding. For while the butterfly sucks nectar or other liquid food, the caterpillar bites up and devours solid vegetable substances, such as the leaves of herbs or trees. It is well known that between the close of its larval life and its attainment of perfection as a butterfly, the insect spends a period as a pupa, fig. 1e, unable to move from place to place and taking no food. Fig 3. Head of caterpillar of goat moth, casus, seen from behind. At feeler MN, mandible MX, maxilla LM, labium, spinneret projecting beyond it. Magnified. After lionette from meal and Denny's cockroach. Such, in brief, is the course of the most familiar of insect life stories. For the student of the animal world as a whole, this familiar transformation raises some startling problems, which have been suggestively treated by F. Brouwer, 1869, L. C. Meal, 1895, J. Lubbock, 1874, R. Hamans, 1907, P. D. Jenner, 1909, and other writers. To appreciate these problems is the first step towards learning the true meaning of the transformation. The butterfly's egg is absolutely and relatively of large size and contains a considerable amount of yolk. As a rule, we find that young animals hatched from such eggs resemble their parents rather closely and pass through no marked changes during their lives. A chicken, a crocodile, a dogfish, a cuttlefish, and a spider afford well-known examples of this rule. Land animals generally produce young which are miniature copies of themselves, for example horses, dogs, and other mammals, snails and slugs, scorpions and earthworms. On the other hand, metamorphosis among animals is associated with eggs of small size, with aquatic habit, and with relatively low zoological rank. The young of a starfish, for example, has hardly a character in common with its parent, while a marine segmented worm and an oyster, unlike enough when adult, develop from closely similar larval forms. If we take a class of animals, the crustacea, nearly allied to insects, we find that its more lowly members, such as water fleas and barnacles, pass through far more striking changes than its higher groups, such as lobsters and woodlice. But among the insects, a class of predominantly terrestrial and aerial creatures producing large eggs, the highest groups undergo, as we shall see, the most profound changes. The life story of the butterfly, then, well known as it may be, furnishes a puzzling exception to some wide-reaching generalizations concerning animal development. And the student of science often finds that an exception to some rule is the key to a problem of the highest interest. During many centuries, naturalists have bent their energies to explain the difficulties presented by insect transformations. Aristotle, the first serious student of organized beings whose writings have been preserved for us, and William Harvey, the famous demonstrator of the mammalian blood circulation 2,000 years later, agreed in regarding the pupa as a second egg. The egg laid by a butterfly had not, according to Harvey, enough store of food to provide for the building up of a complex organism like the parent. Only the imperfect larva could be produced from it. The larva was regarded as feeding voraciously for the purpose of acquiring a large store of nutritive material, after which it was believed to revert to the state of a second but far larger egg, the pupa, from which the winged insect could take origin. Others again, following de Réaumur, 1734, have speculated whether the development of pupa within larva and of winged insect within pupa might not be explained as abnormal births. But a comparison of the transformation of butterflies with simpler insect life stories will convince the inquirer that no such heroic theories as these are necessary. It will be realized that even the most profound transformation among insects can be explained as a special case of growth. End of the chapter. Chapter 2, Growth and Change. The caterpillar differs markedly from the butterfly. As we pursue our studies of insect growth and transformation, we shall find that in some cases the difference between young and adult is much greater, as for example between the maggot and the house fly, in others far less, as between the young and full-grown grasshopper or plant bug. It is evidently wise to begin a general survey of the subject with some of those simpler cases in which the differences between the young and adult insect are comparatively slight. We shall then be in a position to understand better the meaning of the more puzzling and complex cases in which the differences between the stages are profound. In the first place, it is necessary to realize that the changes which any insect passes through during its life story are essentially accompaniments of its growth. The limits of this little book allow only slight reference to features of internal structure. We must be content, in the main, to deal with the outward form. But there is an important relation between this outward form and the underlying living tissues which must be clearly understood. Throughout the great race of animals, the arthropoda, of which insects form a class, the body is covered outwardly by a cuticle or secretion of the underlying layer of living cells which form the outer skin or epidermis, see Fig. 10EP, CU, page 39. This cuticle has regions which are hard and firm, forming an exoskeleton, and between these, areas which are relatively soft and flexible. The firm regions are commonly segmental in their arrangement, and the intervening flexible connections render possible accurate motions of the exoskeletal parts in relation to each other, the motions being due to the contraction of muscles which are attached within the exoskeleton. Now this jointed exoskeleton, an admirably formed suit of armor though it often is, has one drawback. It is not part of the insect's living tissues. It is a cuticle formed by the solidifying of a fluid secreted by the epidermal cells, therefore without life, without the power of growth, and with only a limited capacity for stretching. It follows, therefore, that at least during the period through which the insect continues to grow, the cuticle must be periodically shed. Thus, in the life story of an insect or other arthropod, such as a lobster, a spider, or a centipede, there must be a succession of cuticle castings, molts or ectasis as they are often called. When such a molt is about to take place, the cuticle separates from the underlying epidermis, and a fluid collects beneath. A delicate new cuticle, see Fig. 10CU. Is then formed in contact with the epidermis, and the old cuticle opens, usually with a slit lengthwise along the back, to allow the insect in its new coat to emerge. At first, this new coat is thin and flabby, but after a period of exposure to the air, it hardens and darkens, becoming a worthy and larger successor to that which has been cast. The cuticle, moreover, is by no means wholly external. The greater part of the digestive canal and the whole air tube system are formed by inpushings of the outer skin, ectoderm, and are consequently lined with an extension of the chitinous cuticle, which is shed and renewed at every molt. In all insects, these successive molts tend to be associated with change of form, sometimes slight, sometimes very great. The new cuticle is rarely an exact reproduction of the old one. It exhibits some new features, which are often indications of the insect's approach towards maturity. Even in some of those interesting and primitive insects, the bristletails, Thysanura, and springtails, Columbella, in which wings are never developed, perceptible differences in the form and arrangement of the abdominal limbs can be traced through the successive stages, as are Heymans, 1906, and K.W. Verhoef, 1911, have shown from Achilles. But the changes undergone by such insects are comparatively so slight that the creatures are often known as ametabola, or insects without transformation in the life history. Now there are a considerable number of winged insects, cockroaches and grasshoppers, for example, in which the observable changes are also comparatively slight. We will sketch briefly the main features of the life story of such an insect. Fig. 4. Common cockroach, Blatta orientalis. A. Female, B. Male, C. Side view of female, D. Young. After marlet, entom. Bull. 4. U.S. Department Agric. The young creature is hatched from the egg in a form closely resembling, on the whole, that of its parent, so that the term miniature adult, sometimes applied to it, is not inappropriate. The baby cockroach, Fig. 4D, is known by its flattened body, rounded prothorax, and stiff, jointed tail feelers or cercopods, the baby grasshopper by its strong, elongate hind legs, adapted like those of the adult for vigorous leaping. During the growth of the insect to the adult state, there may be 4 or 5 molts, each preceded and succeeded by a characteristic instar. The first instar differs, however, from the adult in one conspicuous and noteworthy feature. It possesses no trace of wings. But after the first or the second molt, definite wing rudiments are visible in the form of outgrowths on the corners of the second and third thoracic segments. In each succeeding instar, these rudiments become more prominent, and in the fourth or the fifth stage, they show a branching arrangement of air tubes, prefiguring the nervures of the adult wing, Fig. 5. After the last molt, the wings are exposed, articulated to the segments that bear them, and capable of motion. Having been formed beneath the cuticle of the wing rudiments of the penultimate instar, the wings are necessarily abbreviated and crumpled. But during the process of hardening of the cuticle, they rapidly increase in size, blood and air being forced through the nervures, so that the wings, attaining their full expanse and firmness, become suited for the function of flight. Fig. 5. Nymph of locust, Schistosera americana, with distinct wing rudiments. After Howard, Insect Life, Volume 7. The changes through which these insects pass are therefore largely connected with the development of the wings. It is noteworthy that in an immature cockroach, the entire dorsal cuticle is hard and firm. In the adult, however, while the cuticle of the prothorax remains firm, that of the two hinder thoracic and of all the abdominal segments is somewhat thin and delicate on the dorsal aspect. It needs not now to be resistant, because it is covered by the two firm forewings which shield and protect it, except when the insect is flying. There are, indeed, slight changes in other structures not directly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.